So every year we announce the films that Chlotrudis members have voted as the best of the previous year, but the part that most of the people here in this room don't know is how the nominations are selected.
We've talked about it, and we've mentioned some of the criteria here at the award ceremony, but it's only the members who truly know what happens at the annual nominating committee meeting, and that takes place midway through January.
And really, it's only the members who happen to be at the nominating committee meeting. Well, tonight we're going to be recreating that meeting for you, right here on the Broadway stage.
That's right. So sit back and get a little glimpse of the crazy antics that go on during a cold afternoon and evening in midwinter, where a bunch of film buffs get together and argue about film.
Next year, you might just want to take part.
Good,
I know. I'm sick. We didn't start this early last year.
Okay, ready? Let's get started. Honored committee, we have gathered here in Cambridge with pride. Of stuff we're going to nominate. From the films moviegoers underrate, you submitted online what you want to make the cut and try their luck. Chlotrudis noms. Chlotrudis noms. Chlotrudis noms. Chlotrudis noms. Let's make this gratifying, satisfying for us all by ratifying ground rules for the day that we all agree to help us not look like fools, call each other tools or boards. The films are weighted, equated, our ratio is stated, so nothing overrated, so unabated becomes inflated. And lesser seen films, of course, have a fair and fighting chance. A movie release that's slow makes the film worthy, and we saw on DVD or IFC and called by a festival. The rounds we just ignore. Our first category's up. It's up to go fast. Ensemble cast.
Chronicle, Art of the
skill competes with exit through the gift shop. Joan Rivers delivers a statuette for crystal meth, a lover that holds your breath. Jacko's boating, mother, undertow. Winter's bone, learn to own your own crone.
That's fucking retarded.
It is an honor of choices we all own. So hold your qualms.
After the main ballad is set, a potluck dinner commences. Amanda Doran contributes her special creation in honor of the documentary Marwin Call, an entire Belgian village sculpted from aerosol tubes and micro lenses.
Julie Blumenthal called Marilyn on Twitter to persuade her to take one nomination for someone other than
Brian Tim, is about the documentary Catfish, and wonders if what the message is that Chlotrudis sends should be nominated for buried treasure, which proves to be pointless because only one person nominated for anything, and it wasn't Brian.
Brian laments so his Inferno wasn't nominated for documentary.
And Jason Bieber, having seen a 114 record setting eligible film, has his presence on films nobody else saw, such as Laws of the Human which he replies,
actually, I'm nominated for Ensemble Cast!
His dead wife comes to check on when he was a fish. Uncle. Rocks when a past life thoughts and it calms you down now. When it's time for him to take solace in a cave with a roof of stars. Now he'll go his way.
Before you die. Hi, everyone, and welcome. We're going to start in just about 2 minutes, and we'll be off in a moment. Thank you.
Wow. You know, I've been presenting at this award show for a couple of years now, and I can't say I've ever been introduced my song before. That'll probably be the last time that happens. Anyway, I'm here to introduce Sarah Rubin. She is the artistic director of the Boston Jewish Film Festival, one of Chlotrudis' favorite Boston film festivals. The festival presents the best contemporary films from around the world on Jewish themes at its annual festival and throughout the year. From features, shorts, documentaries, and conversations with visiting artists, the festival explores Jewish identity, the current Jewish experience, and the richness of Jewish culture in relation to a diverse modern world. Sarah Rubin.
Thank you, Chris, and it's great to see all of you here tonight. I just wanted to mention for anybody who voted for Alfred Molina, they can see him in an even smaller film than Education. We're showing a sneak preview of The Little Traitor Thursday night with director Lynn Roth at West Newton Cinema at 7 o'clock. And Buried Treasure actually has 5 nominees, so they are Bronson, as you saw, Cherry Blossoms, The New Year Parade, Up Time in the City, and The very unmusical Summer's Town. and it really is. And the winner is Brunson. Yeah.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's virtual presentation of the 27th Annual Chlotrudis Awards. My name is Michael Colford, and I'm the president of the Chlotrudis Society for Independent Film, and I hope you enjoyed, for those of you who caught the pre-show, that a little glimpse of what some of our live shows were like. And sorry for the delay, there's some issues with people getting the link, so I've been sending links out to people. But here we go, we're about to start. I want to start by sending out my best thanks and a quick recovery to Ivy Moylan, my Chlotrudis co-host for the last 13 consecutive years and the executive director of the Brattle Film Foundation, who endured unexpected dental surgery on Friday and didn't feel up to the gig this weekend. We miss you, Ivy, and it won't be the same without you. Because we're going virtual tonight, we have a lot of folks in attendance who have never been to one of our award ceremonies before and might not know a lot about Chlotrudis. I'm going to take just a little time to tell you about the organization and how this year was quite a bit different than a usual movie viewing year. While I'm looking forward to getting together to celebrate independent film in person again, there are some benefits to a virtual ceremony, including welcoming members, guests, and friends from all over the world. We even have some of this year's nominees in the audience, something we don't usually have. And I thought we'd take a moment to let them say hello and introduce themselves. So if we could have Hannah promoted to presenter and she can say hello. Give us a moment while we work out the little tech quirks. There she is. Hi, Hannah.
Hello. My name is Hannah Mosqueda, as you can probably see on the little thing under my name now. I play Jenny in a film called Gutterbug, and I'm just blown away by the nomination. I really wasn't expecting anything like it. And especially because Jenny is very special to me as a role, I just couldn't be more pleased to be here tonight. So thank you very much for inviting me. And I look forward to watching the rest of the ceremony.
Thanks so much, Hannah. We're so happy you could be with us. And for those who have not been following along, Hannah has been nominated for a Best Supporting Actress Award in the role in Gutterbug. And now if we have an opportunity to promote Paul Harrell to presenters, he is also nominated this year as the director for Buried Treasure nominee, Light from Light. Paul, if you'd like to say hello.
Hi, everyone. I just wanted to thank you for having me at your party. I wrote the script for Light from Light thinking, no one is probably ever going to fund this movie, but I just have to write it. And then when we did find funding, we made it not knowing really if anyone would ever see it. So after we were nominated, the producers of the film and I, we were reading about the history of these awards. And we were like, these are our people. this is our tribe. So I wanted to be here tonight to just say on behalf of the entire Light from Light team, how meaningful it is for us to be recognized with a nomination, and to thank you for what you do for film, sincerely. And thanks again for having me at your party.
Thank you, Paul. Thanks so much for joining us, and thanks for those nice words. And best of luck to both you and Hannah. Now, to tell you a little bit about how Chlotrudis operated this year, many of you know this, but there are certain rules and guidelines that govern what is considered a Chlotrudis film. In a normal year, only films that receive distribution on less than 1,000 screens domestically is eligible for Chlotrudis consideration. But in a year when very few films receive theatrical release at all, and so many films were going direct to streaming services, we had to loosen our rules. Certainly, we still considered films that were screened virtually through theaters that usually screen independent films. But for the first time ever, we also considered films that were released directly through streaming services. This made determining true independent films much more difficult. We looked at the production companies that made the films, and if a Hollywood studio was involved, or if one of the big streaming entities like Netflix or Amazon Prime was directly involved in the film's production, we would discount it. But really, it was all a guessing game. For example, if I'm thinking of Ending Things, Charlie Kaufman's film that racked up 6 nominations, or even The Sound of Metal, a favorite among many members that received 5 nominations, if either of those films had been released in theaters, would they have broken through the 1,000 screen limit? It's possible. And if that had been the case, they would not have been eligible. Not because they weren't independently produced or not fantastic films, but because from a Chlotrudis viewpoint, they just weren't overlooked or would have reached a much broader audience than, say, a film like Beanpole or And Then We Danced. The fact that many of these films might have potentially reached an even broader audience through streaming platforms was something that we had to just put aside. It was really the only way we could see many of the films that were actually released this year. Then there's the buried treasure, which is the organization's signature award. We created the buried treasure because even amongst all the independent films that we honor, there are definite levels of awareness, even in the movie industry. We created the Buried Treasure Award to really honor the films that were truly overlooked, even among independent film fans. Like Paul said, he wasn't even sure if he'd find an audience for his film. So the Buried Treasure category was an opportunity for us to be able to spotlight a little bit more. A film was traditionally eligible for the Buried Treasure category only if it earned less than $250,000 at the domestic box office. This year, that was probably the case for most films when it comes to theatrical box office. So this year we just had to talk about it at our nominating committee meeting and create a slate of nominees for that category that just felt like buried treasures to us. It wasn't easy, but I'm actually very proud to say that I think this year's slate of buried treasures is one of our best. And you'll get to see clips from each of our buried treasure nominees tonight, and hopefully your interest will be piqued enough that you'll give them a try in their entirety. And a little note about the clips we got for our buried treasures. I reached out to each of the filmmaking distribution companies and asked for a clip, and I got a wide assortment of different kinds of clips. Usually we kind of try to do just a clip from each film, but we got very different kinds of clips, so you'll get to see a little bit of everything in these clips. For me, personally, with regard to viewing movies, this pandemic year was one that created a lot of conflicting emotions. In the past 10 years or so, because of lots of reasons, I found I was going to see movies at the theater less and less. The films that I did see on the big screen were often at film festivals. Chlotrudis members can only nominate if they see a minimum of 25 eligible films in a year. And honestly, in the past 7 to 10 years, I probably averaged about 40 films a year. This year, being stuck at home with little to do in the evenings but consume media, I made a concerted effort to focus on independent films and ended up seeing nearly 110 eligible films through virtual cinema screenings, film festivals, and streaming outlets. I saw more films in a year than I had for over a decade, but I also missed going to the cinema more than ever. Despite this unorthodox year, there were lots of great movies released, and the nominees speak to that quality and variety of storytelling in film. And going through the results on this year's Chlotrudis Award ballots, it was really kind of amazing to see how members' votes ran the gamut all across the board, showing how difficult it was this year to select which films came out on top. And now, but nowhere was that more evident than this year's excellent crop of buried treasure nominees. We're gonna get things started with our first buried treasure nominee clip, Ghost Tropic.
Mm-hmm. quelle histoire.
Je suis allée tout au bout jusqu'à Herman de Brou. Et là, du coup, il n'y a plus de métro. Tu m'appelles quand t'as ce message? D'accord?
Sure, I'll say this about all the Buried Treasure nominees, but Ghost Tropic is a beautiful film, and I hope you all take a moment to watch it. We're here for our first batch of awards. So to present the awards in the writing categories, I'd like to introduce Beth Caldwell, who's one of our former board members, who's coming to us from Ithaca, New York, and Shannon Dout, who is a current board member coming from Los Angeles, California, Santa Monica, California. Welcome, Beth and Shannon.
Hello everyone, I'm Beth Caldwell.
And I'm Shannon Dout, nice to be here, and thank you, Michael, for putting this together.
Yes, it's wonderful to be here. So anyway, first I'd like to read the nominees for Best Original Screenplay. The nominees are Farewell Amour, screenplay by Ekwa Masanji, Kajillionaire, screenplay by Miranda July, Never Rarely, Sometimes Always, screenplay by Eliza Hittman, Sorry We Missed You, screenplay by Paul Liberty, excuse me, and then Sound of Metal, screenplay by Darius Marder, Abraham Marder, story by Darius Marder and Derek Cianfrance.
And the award goes to Never Rarely, Sometimes Always, screenplay by Eliza Hittman. Congratulations, Eliza.
Yes.
The next category is for Best Adapted Screenplay. And the nominees are I'm Thinking of Ending Things, screenplay by Charlie Kaufman, based on the book by Ian Reid, Mouthpiece, screenplay by Patricia Rosema, based on the play by Amy Nosbakken and Nora Sadava. Shirley, screenplay by Sarah Gubbins, based on the book by Susan Scarf Merrill. And last, Words on Bathroom Walls, screenplay by Nick Nevada, based on the book by Julia Walton.
Thank you. And the winner goes to Shirley, screenplay by Sarah Gubbins, based on the book by Susan Scarf Merrill. Congratulations.
And now we're here for our next buried treasure clip for the film Cat in the Wall.
ти си права, че трябва стел.
Това е дупката на котката. Гледай от какво се прави. Добреш, но? И то е екологично. И то не, органик. И чакай да къде си тръгна сега.
Снявам се.
If you are a professional filmmaker, you can see that it's not documentary at all. It's very well organized, it's scripted, also it's funded. So it's all the actors are professional, the main actors, and few others from the block are natural people living there. It's completely fictionalized, and it took a lot of work to look so natural. Also, the actors, they wanted, they put a lot of intuition in the things, because as well, although it was written, we actually put them in a so realistic environment that they kind of had to be realistic, had to be part of it.
I mean,
it costs £10, yeah? It costs £10 to get a cab. Okay. £10 to get a cab. But no, you're fucking teasing.
Quite in love with the British culture, their humor, with the laughter and the whole culture. The fact that we do critical films, we do them in Bulgaria as well. I mean, we criticize, we try to be
to put a mirror of that society. And if somebody
is offended,
it's not our problem. It's kind of sometimes we have an anger or something to say.
So they escalate to call each other names and they argue on racial and cultural issues. So this is a small problem that escalates into a real fire.
The mighty force of nature, as they called us in Screen International, they called Irina Atanasova the main actress.
When I met the Mina and Vesela, they were in the process of looking for a main part actress, and I don't know why they chose me. I still don't know why.
We've always been an international country. We remain an international country.
You soak up our benefit, and now you take our cut as well.
Our main focus, the main motivation, was to do to observe this phenomenal case about how the particular London Council in Peckham uses people, the middle classes, like cash points, like one of the characters says in the film. And we wanted to look at the housing crisis and the multicultural tensions.
Bloody works. You know, and I don't want to say bloody.
Okay,
I'm sorry, we pay for the major works, not you. So we live here and basically we can stay as long as we fancy. So when are you using?
We are owners. We are the top owners.
Yeah, I said it.
It's probably not happening. We're gonna have to go through this because we see how
the pence to buy no good broth.
The idea is we've got actually slavery. Yeah.
And that's what took a mix with the tetra now.
So we
was just the cutest cat I've ever seen in my life.
Even cuter than the girls in the school?
Yes.
Really? Кое ти е любимото животно, например?
Мишка. I am the business man.
Our second buried treasure clip, Cat in the Wall, another one I would highly recommend. And thanks to those filmmakers for sending us that whole little making of piece. That was very nice. So we're very excited to have our first guest. And for our guests this year, since we weren't, since we are going virtual and we could go a little bit further afield, we thought we'd look back to acknowledge one of last year's winners, since we had to sadly cancel our event at the start of the shutdown. Since Iceland had such a great year with Chlotrudis last year, we thought it would be fitting to present last year's Best Director Trudy to Isold Uggadottir for her superb debut feature film, And Breathe Normally, which won the World Cinema Dramatic Directing Award at the Sundance Film Festival in 2018. I first saw the film at the Provençal International Film Festival, and it was my favorite film of the festival, a sentiment shared by many others, apparently, as it won that year's Audience Award. Released officially in the States in 2019, it was nominated by the Chlotrudis Society in 5 categories: Best Movie, Best Director, Best Actress, Best Supporting Actress, and Best Original Screenplay. And Breathe Normally faced some stiff competition in these categories, but Isold managed to tie with Parasite director Bong Joon-ho for the Best Director Award. 5 nominations and a shared Best Director win is a notable feat for her first time out. And to add to that, And Breathe Normally placed 43rd in the Chlotrudis Society's top 100 films of the last decade. Born in Reykjavik, Isold lived for several years in New York, where she earned her MFA in directing and screenwriting from Columbia University School of Arts. She wrote, directed, and edited 4 award-winning short films before she made her first feature. I watched And Breathe Normally again this weekend in preparation for Isold's appearance, and I was struck again how beautiful, both technically and emotionally, it was. Isold's assured writing and directing are both on display here, as the dialogue is so sparse and so much of the story is told through visuals or the amazing faces of the actors involved. The story is filled with emotion, yet it's a subtle and powerful work, and despite the somber tone, filled with kindness and hope. We have a trailer here that captures the film well, so let's take a look at the trailer.
Mætti ég?
Sjálfsa.
Er þið saman þá ég taki 2 aukaskanda?
Já, ekkert mál.
Ætti með allir hennar krakka undir bílu og vil ekki skilja út undan. Ég skan, bara auðið henni byggði bílum. Hvað bara er? Ég bara djóka.
Ertu ekki að fucking grínast?
Varstu kannski að vinna í lottó eða?
Nei, kannski ekki lottó, samt.
Svo eins og þið vitið þá kemur þannig bara í ljós við lok starfs námsins. Hvert ykkar eigi möguleika á fastráðningu?
Einhverju spurningar?
Can I have your passport and boarding pass, please?
Áttu ekki verið blátt?
Do you know how long I have to stay here?
You're not in prison. You know the kind with bars anyway.
Það þarf að duðlega strákur að koma með mömmu í Jósefverð. En þú manst, B2 er það einu sem ég á hluta. Ætlar ekki að keyra konuna líka? Hann er greið hárið svo að festist uppi.
Accept the 2020 Chlotrudis Award for Best Direction of a Feature Film. Please welcome Isold Uggadottir.
Hi, Michael, and thank you all who are watching and to the Chlotrudis Society. This is an amazing honor and unexpected in every way, both when you reached out this year, as well as last year when I heard about all the nominations. It was such a pleasant surprise and a pleasant discovery to learn of your organization that that champions independent film, artistic films, foreign films. The foreign films do tend to get lost sometimes, so it's such a nice experience to have a US organization include the foreign films that, you know, people aren't always fans of subtitles. So it's great to be acknowledged and included. An absolute surprise. But amazing to get to experience with you this year, as opposed to just kind of follow everything online. And I watched the pre-show and it looks like it's a fun bunch who are involved in the society. So maybe one day I can attend in person, that would be amazing. But thank you so much. Thank you for your organization, which I understand has been around for a long time and growing. So thank you for just keeping it up and highlighting these films that people might sometimes miss. So thank you.
Thank you, Isold, and congratulations.
Thank you so much.
So next up, we asked two-time Chlotrudis Award-winning writer-director Wiebke von Karelsfeld to have a chat with Isold about her work. Wiebke began her film career as an editor, working on such films as Exotica and The Five Senses. Her debut film, Marion Bridge, was nominated for 3 Chlotrudis Awards at our 10th award ceremony in 2004, including Best Adapted Screenplay and Best Ensemble Cast. She took home the Buried Treasure Award that year. In 2017, Wiebke won the Best Adapted Screenplay Awards for her third feature, The Saver, which also saw a nomination for lead actress, Imogen Cardinal. Wiebke published her first novel, Claremont, in 2019 and is already working on her follow-up. So now let's take a listen in on Wiebke and Isold as they chatted the other day.
Hi Isold.
Hi Wiebke.
Very nice to meet you and big congratulations on your film, but also on the award, obviously.
Thank you so much. It's a real honor to be awarded last year and also to be part of this event this year as well.
Yeah, it's the Chlotrudis Society is a wonderful, wonderful society of film lovers. But I have to say, I loved your film. I loved it the first time I saw it, and I've seen it 3 times since. And I think it's a beautiful, beautiful piece of filmmaking. So it's a much deserved award. One of the things I really loved about it, how self-assured it is. Like, it's your first feature film, if I understand it correctly, but it has very much an assuredness about it that is interesting, like in the imagery, but also in the storytelling and the pacing. Like, it seems slow, but then it actually jumps forward through all the plot points and focuses on the emotions. And I'm wondering, is that something that you were conscious of doing already in the script phase, or did it come about as you were shooting it, or was that paring down in the editing? I'm just wondering about the process.
Yeah, I mean, it's first of all, a very long process, and I'm sure much of it is, you know, I'm aware of the decisions, but also it's just so many things. I mean, as you know, as a filmmaker yourself, so many things have to come together for it to work. And yes, it is my first feature, but I had made directed four short films prior to that. I lived in New York City, although I live in Iceland now, I'm from Iceland, but I worked as an editor in New York City. So I have this kind of very linear kind of editor's mind, maybe, perhaps. Yes. So I feel like in this, you know, in the screenwriting as well, I think in frames, I think in shots, in a way. Of course, you know, an emotion, like, that's where the story comes from originally. It's, I want to tell this emotional story between two individuals, but in the actual kind of pacing of it, I feel like, yeah, I tend to you know, especially when I'm lost in the writing, I kind of pretend like I'm in the theater watching the movie. I'm like, what's that? You know, looking for the rhythm. And sometimes I play some specific types of kind of abstract music to kind of get myself into the mindset and the rhythm of the film. And so, you know, and while I'm not a musician at all, there's something rhythmic about the thinking.
But there is. Yeah, there is very much, because like there's a lot of sort of technical stuff that you could have gotten hung up on, like all the immigration stuff, all the poverty, like even the losing, like even the way the interaction with the friend's mother, like they're so minimally handled, but beautifully and self-assured. I
I think some of it comes out of fear of giving people too much, because I'm also very aware of, you know, you want to keep them engaged in a way where they're not bored and where people keep kind of guessing. People, you know, I'm not a fan of films where the people are spoon-fed too much. You give them too much. You're like, okay, I get it. I don't need all this information. And so something slightly abstract, a little bit vague. Life is not clean cut always. It is a little bit chaotic, and we don't know the answers to all the questions. And you might meet somebody and have some general idea of their background. I don't feel like I have to tell them everything about their background.
And I mean, you did this wonderfully. But as a filmmaker, I guess my question is, sometimes when I write a script,
yeah,
you give it to funders, they're like, well, I don't understand. And then
there was all of that. It didn't happen overnight. The film, I lived in New York City for 10 years working in film and editing and getting my master's degree and spending, you know, time immersing myself in this whole world of film. Coming back to Iceland 2011, maybe I said one early, anyway, 2011, came back and thought I'd be like, you know, let me quickly write a screenplay and make a movie. And of course, it's, you know, it's not like that. It's like half a decade later, you're on set. But so it's, yeah, it's the funders, of course. Yeah, there are funders that said no, you know, especially maybe in the early time or something, or something is too vague. And at the end of the day, funders are just normal human beings with different tastes. People have, so people are coming from all different directions. And that's something I think I had to learn also through the process. You know, you kind of learn to not take things personally. And and also a reminder to myself is that everyone is operating from some level of fear, that is fear of mistakes. And that goes for producers or financiers or funders and us as filmmakers, is we're always afraid of, like, is this the right decision? Yeah. Is it? Because, you know, we're always, and especially as directors, we're faced with decisions constantly. Yeah. Like, is the script getting, you know, is it right? Is the casting, is this first, this lead character of ours, Kristin Thora, who I was very determined about, but, you know, she hadn't done a whole lot of film in Iceland. So, you know, you have to make the case, and then you have to be like, am I sure? I feel like I'm sure, but am I sure? But I felt very strongly about her. Same with Papadita and the Belgian actress, originally from Guinea-Bissau. I felt very strongly about her, but you're faced with choices all the time.
You did a lot of very, very good choices. So the actors is obviously something that was going to be my next question.
About
the actors, because they're so amazing. And maybe we'll just talk quickly about both of them, because the Icelandic, I thought they were both incredible. Kristen, she was really interesting, because in North America, anyways, you hardly ever find actresses like that, with that physicality, because it is such a focus on, like, I'm gonna just say surface beauty.
Yeah.
She really owned that part, and I bought her the struggle that she was going through. But yeah, tell me a little bit about how you found her.
Yeah, I had seen her in a play in Reykjavik some years before casting, and I thought to myself, wow, she has this intensity about her. I could just feel her talent. I could just feel what a strong performer she is. And yet I thought, I don't really see her in films in Iceland. That's strange. Let me, you know, and I just kind of kept her in the back of my mind. And then finally, when everything kind of came together, the script, the funding and all that, and we were in a position to cast, she was one of the actresses brought in. And one of the roles or the scenes that she had to deliver was a scene that we call the moment of truth, where these two women sit in a car and they kind of open up a little bit to one another, to the extent that they're willing and able to do that, because up until then they've been quite closed and reserved with their emotions. And it's a scene that I was afraid of myself as the writer, because I was like, ah, oh, it's a scene that if it's not done well, it can be really cheesy and awkward and silly or stupid or something. That was, again, you know, operating from fear. I was afraid that that would, yeah, that potentially couldn't work. But she did it in such a way where I forgot that that was my own writing. And she goes so deep and she has such layered performances that that I really felt for her. And you could kind of see her kind of on the verge of tears, but never going too far. She just finds that perfect balance right. of giving you a lot without going right. too far.
So was it a fight to be able to cast her?
I mean, well, you know, off the record, let's say what, you know, I would have been willing to cast her, you know, within those few weeks where we were doing the casting. But yeah, I will just say here very honestly, I had to wait for quite a number of months to be able to confirm her. Right. And again, I think it's just people are like, well, have you checked so-and-so? Have you checked so-and-so? So-and-so has done more, this and this and that. And that's just the reality that, you know, people go through because it's, you're bringing in somebody that, you know, doesn't have like box off, you know, and I'm talking Icelandic terms,
yeah,
box
yeah, yeah.
office, whatever that means. But in the, you know, in some cases, yeah, there's people are looking like, we have to sell. How do we sell this? Right. And I'm always operating from, I don't care. That's not the reason I'm making this movie. I wouldn't be in film if that was the reason I'm not drawn to that, to film for that reason. So I go from a different, totally different place. I'm just like, who can do this correctly? Well, and the great thing about Kristin Thorne also was because she hadn't done so much film at that point, she did so much preparation, so much homework. She brought, you know, every day she brought so much. I mean, she like pushed, you know, she was so mentally present. She was so incredibly present, preparing herself, listening to podcasts, listening to people who had perhaps, you know, had struggles, who had struggled with, you know, addiction, poverty, living in the car, just, you know, not succeeding.
And you can feel it. You can,
yeah.
feel, you can so, feel it.
And the same with Papatita Sadio.
Yes.
They shared that quality of really loving their art and really wanting to go the extra mile always and preparing, just, yeah, being incredibly present at every moment. And that's, of course, I mean, it's a great place to be in. But also, I mean, there's also an intensity on the set because everybody wants to do so well. And of course, actors want more takes. I have a limited schedule because it's an independent film that we only have this much time. So yeah, I'll admit there were times when actresses were like, you know, why do you always say cut at this point? And I'm like, it's because I got pressure from somewhere else. You know, everybody has pressure from somewhere. So I would love to give them as, you know, and I, right. but I said, don't worry. I will never call cut or end the scene unless we have it. You know, I won't fail you by finishing the setup unless we've delivered. So don't worry.
No, and you did not fail. I mean, the incredible thing about Bebita is that I've seen some photos of her and she's actually quite glamorous.
She's very glamorous. And I had no idea because I went to Brussels for the casting. There were, you know, 10 women who could have potentially taken the role. And she came in, so she dressed the part of an asylum seeker who was on the road, who had a difficult time. And she, you know, in a good way, fooled me into believing this. I was like, oh, this is just her, you know, feel so close to her reality. This must be her reality. Granted, she is an immigrant. She did, you know, immigrate from Guinea-Bissau. So she knows something as a child. But she's very beautiful, you know, glamorous woman in her everyday normal life. So, but she knew what the role required and knew that the director might, you know, maybe the director could be limited in you know, imagination and, you know, came in very much looking like somebody who was going through a lot.
Well, I mean, she was absolutely incredible. I mean, what, this is going to sound weird, but one of the things I loved about her is the way she walks. Like, they have several shots where she walks away.
Yeah.
It is something in the way she walks, the determinedness, like,
yeah,
faintness and determined at the same time. That's just, I don't know, I thought it was very...
Yeah, exactly. I mean, she has that about her where she's this proud woman who is like struggling, but she's like, I'm not going to tell you about it. You know, yes, there are some things I'm dealing with, but I'm on a mission regardless. Like, I'm also a fighter.
I think one of the main reasons I love this movie so much is also because there's this idea of kindness, and mm-hmm. that kindness, you know, kindness will rule the day. Yeah. Like that moment when she sees the Icelandic woman sleep in the car,
yeah,
in the rain. Was that real rain, or did you make the rain?
No, that was Icelandic rain all the way. Okay. Not all that weather. It was just, you know, compliments of Iceland. Thank you very much. So, but there was nothing.
But it's so perfect. Like, she's in the rain. It's so miserable. She has every reason to walk away. She has every reason not to help.
Yeah.
After all, it's her who put her into the situation, and then she walks away. And again, it's like this beautiful thing. She walks away, and then it cuts to, and they're waking up or falling asleep. I can't remember, but
yeah. I mean, I think for some of these moments where there's a difficult decision. I mean, again, like just like us, the filmmakers, the humans are dealing with decisions, and here she is. You know, she sees something. She's like, wait, there's something off. Let me check. Uh huh. And she recognizes who these people are. There's a woman and a child, and she knows. And, you know, part of her is like, this is not my problem. I'm, you know, I can't get involved. And then, you know, there's this pause of like, but I have to. And I feel like we can all kind of relate to it of, you know, something you're like, well, I'm not obligated to help or become involved in this problem, but I'm human, and well, sometimes you just can't help being human.
Well, that's it. Then ultimately her redemption comes out of that act of kindness, right?
Mm-hmm. So yeah,
it's a very hopeful message in that way.
Yeah, thank you. So, I mean, it wasn't conscious. It was just it evolved in the writing, because in the beginning, right, it was me wanting to talk about poverty and women in a car and a child and, you know, not being able to kind of get by.
Right.
And then adding the story of the
refugee.
Yeah.
That's interesting, because I had one more question, but I think we have to wrap it up soon. But yeah. I had one more question, which was about this whole, like, my idea of Iceland is a quite affluent country and a very just country. And it was so interesting to see that there are quite large holes in the safety net also. Yeah. So I was wondering, like, what was first, wanting to talk about that or wanting to talk about these two women?
I would say it was about poverty first, because I mean, I was living in New York City during the economic crisis in Iceland. I observed it every minute of the day. I was obsessed with it. Of course, it affected my studies in New York. My krona, my Icelandic currency, became very devalued. Right. And yeah, I felt angry. I was like angry. I mean, I hate capitalism. I'm like, fierce hater of capitalism, which has ruined so much. So I first thought I was, because I made a short film about somebody who is dealing with economic crisis. And so I thought my first feature would be kind of that. Right. And then as I evolved the material, I knew I had that visual of a car, child, mother, not having a home. Writing that for a while, 6 months, a year, probably taking it to workshops, and then getting kind of little delicate notes saying, I think your story needs to go do more. Like, this is not enough, or it's too European was the note. Anyway, so while I was grappling with the film being too European, I observed more and more, I started noticing stories in the newspaper in Iceland about refugees being stuck in between, you know, in the system, sometimes being arrested on their way to Canada, going somewhere else. And so I started attending talks. I became a volunteer at the Red Cross. I just became kind of involved in that community to understand more, got to know some people personally, and got to know a woman from Uganda who had fled due to her sexuality, and became really excited about tackling this. I was like, this is what I really need to talk about. And so, you know, then after that, you know, here's the cut to me sitting in the library being like, this story and this story, how to tell both. And spending a lot of time at the airport town where the film takes place. They had an asylum there for refugees, which I would visit. I would just kind of spent time like in that area, photographing, procrastinating because writing is so difficult, and yes, trying to look for inspiration,
right?
And dealing with it all a bit like it was a puzzle. Like, okay, I knew kind of early on, like, I was like, I feel like I have an ending in me. Like, this is kind of where a film like this would end, and I know where I want to end it, right. And I kind of know where it would start. But what do we do with the middle?
Well, that's what I need. I need a beginning and an end, and then the rest. But it's not so easy.
No, I know exactly. It's, you know, and then you have these little breakthrough moments, as you know, as a filmmaker yourself, when you're like, I know where they meet first, or I know where the turning point is, and then you have a little victory dance at the library. People have no idea why you're, you know, celebrating in a, you know, your little personal victory lap. Right. And then you can continue, like, okay. So they're the little mini victories that help you survive this grueling process of writing.
Yeah. Well, I hope this award, you will look at the award, and I have a couple up there from the Chlotrudis. It does help me, you know, to keep going and to.
Thank you. Yeah, it really means a lot. I'm really thankful to the society and to you for conducting this interview. And hopefully I can, you know, attend in person one day. It would be amazing.
Yeah.
But it's been an honor to have my work acknowledged by such an important society that focuses on independent artistic voices. So
that's what they do. That's what they love. And you did a beautiful, beautiful film. So I can't wait to see your next one.
Thank you so much. And thank you for having me.
Listen to that radio interview you did. The prophetic dreams. That happened. Whatever it means, that happened. People think ghosts are scary. I think it would be wonderful if they were real.
Light from Light, another beautiful film nominated for a Buried Treasure Award this year. Really just a gorgeous and haunting film. I hope you get to see that one as well. For our next group of acting awards, I would like to welcome two of our board of directors, Beth Curran and Hilary Bajai. Please welcome Beth and Hilary.
Thank you, Michael. I'm Beth. And we have the honor of doing the acting awards. So we're gonna do a little ping pong. We've got five categories. So I'll begin and do the nominees and announce the winner. And then Hilary will go back and forth and take a lot of notes. We've got a lot of stuff going on. So in the category of best performance by an ensemble cast, the nominees are Another Round, Blow the Man Down, I'm Thinking of Ending Things, Kajillionaire, Lovers Rock, Sorry We Missed You. And the Trudy goes to the cast of Jillionaire for the best performance by an ensemble cast. Congratulations.
Hey. For best supporting actor, the nominees are Christopher Abbott for the role of Gabe in Black Bear, Orlan Asenov for the role of Jojo in Cat in the Wall, Osmond Benjamin for the role of Dee in The 40-Year-Old Virgin, Ben Mendelsohn for the role of Henry in Baby Teeth, Paul Racy for the role of Joe in Sound of Metal, and David Thewlis for the role of Father in I'm Thinking of Ending Things. And the Trudy goes to Orlan Asenov for the role of Jojo in Cat in the Wall.
In the category of Best Supporting Actress, the nominees are Jane Addams for the role of Jane in She Dies Tomorrow, Toni Collette for the role of Mother in I'm Thinking of Ending Things, Hannah Waskera for the role of Jenny in Gutterbug, Vasilisa Prelegenina for the role of Masha in Beanpole, Ramona Edith Williams for the role of Frances in St. Francis, Deborah Winger for the role of Teresa in Kajillionaire. And the Trudy goes to Vasilisa Prelegenina for Beanpole.
In the category of Best Actor, the nominees are Riz Ahmed for the role of Ruben in Sound of Metal, John Boyega for the role of Leroy Logan in Red, White, and Blue, Levin Gelenbinki for the role of Merab in Then We Danced, Delroy Lindo for the role of Paul in De Five Bloods, John Magaro in the role of Cookie in First Cow, and Mads Mikkelsen in the role of Martin in Another Round. And the Trudy goes to, we actually have a tie. Riz Ahmed for the role of Ruben in The Sound of Metal, and Levan Galbenkiani for the role of Merab in Then We Danced.
Oh, nice. We always usually have a tie in the acting categories. They're very fiercely fought. Finally, in the last category for the acting awards, in the category of Best Actress, the nominees are Tsai Chin for the role of Grandma in Lucky Grandma, Sydney Flanagan for the role of Autumn in Never, Rarely, Sometimes, Always, Adele Anel for the role of Eloise in Portrait of Lady in Fire, Aubrey Plaza for the role of Allison in Black Bear, Eliza Scanlon for the role of Mila in Baby Teeth, Evan Rachel Wood for the role of Old Olio in Kajillionaire. And the Trudy goes to Sydney Flanagan for Never, Rarely, Sometimes, Always.
J'avais jamais rien eu à moi jusque-là. Et d'un coup, j'avais tellement de choses que j'avais peur de faire une bêtise et de tout perdre. J'avais un abri rien qu'à moi. J'avais un nom rien que pour moi. Et j'avais ma Noël et rien qu'à moi. Je savais même pas s'il y avait assez de place en moi pour autant de bonheur. Et ce cadeau me tombait du ciel tout d'un coup. J'aurais vraiment voulu le partager avec ma maman et avec 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 et 8. Tant de bonheur, c'est rare.
Mon garçon, enfin, fais pas ça, tu me chatouilles. Je m'entraîne ici, moi, c'est pas un jeu.
Dans mon métier, si tu n'es pas le meilleur, tu meurs de faim, même si t'es le meilleur. Je suis pauvre, Anna, mon petit gars. Et maintenant, toi aussi, tu es pauvre. Eh oui, tu es pauvre par alliance. Si on veut, ça. Mais quand on sera riche, je te donnerai un hot dog et du gruyère tous les jours. Mais arrête de me lécher quand je travaille, sinon je vais me briser le cou. Et alors là, mon garçon, on est foutu.
Pauvre, tu veux rire? Avec autant de bonnes choses, j'étais le chien le plus riche du monde. ciel.
We're not only about cats, we like dogs too. And Morona's Fantastic Tale was quite a joy to experience. But I suppose it's no surprise that a documentary about street cats living in Istanbul might be a hit with the Chlotrudis Society for Independent Film. Oh, have I not mentioned to any newcomers that the name Chlotrudis comes from the name of my cat and my then boyfriend roommate's cat when we were all roommates? My cat was named Gertrudis and the other cat was named Chloe. Put them together, Chlotrudis. At any rate, the cats might have been the hook for some of us, but it was the artful storytelling and sublime filmmaking that wowed us. KEDI, Turkish for cat, was released in the States in early 2017 and took the Chlotrudis Best Documentary Award at the 23rd Annual Award Ceremony in March of 2018. After growing up in Istanbul and Jordan, Ceyda Torun moved to the US where she attended high school and then graduated from Boston University with a degree in anthropology. She returned to Turkey to begin her work as an assistant director, then returned to the US, where she co-founded the production company Termite Films with her cinematographer and husband, Charlie Wupperman. Charlie graduated from the London Film School with a Master of Arts in Cinematography, after which he began shooting music videos, commercials, and documentaries in his native Germany and all over Europe. In 2009, he moved to Los Angeles permanently and has since shot the narrative feature films, Bhopal, A Prayer for Rain, Blood Moon, and A Country Called Home. It's doubtful that Charlie ever envisioned himself lying on the streets of Istanbul, tracking over-the-shoulder shots with cats in order to shoot a documentary. He even constructed a special rig for filming the cats at street level. Ceyda made her feature directorial debut with KEDI after working as an assistant director in television. Producing and directing KEDI, she not only paints a portrait of Istanbul that is both intimate and grand, she brings to life the four-legged stars, delving into their unique personalities and, more importantly, how they enrich the entire city and the people with whom they interact in a way that is both magical and profound. Let's take a look at a clip from KEDI and you will understand what I'm talking about.
Kedi, kediden öte bir şey İstanbul'da. Kedi, bütün İstanbul'un bir tarif edilmez karmaşası, kültürü ve özgünlüğüyle, özelliğiyle ilgili bir şey. Ve kediyi kaldırırsan İstanbul'un bir yeri daha tamamen yok olur ve bunun benzeri yoktur dünyada.
Saymadım köyden göçeli Mevsimler geldi geçti görüşmeyeli Hiç haber göndermedin o günden beri Yoksa bana küstün mü unuttun mu beni Dün yine seni andım gözlerim doldu O tatlı günlerimiz bir anı oldu Ay
Ayrılık geldi başa, katlanmak gerek. Seni çok çok özledim, arkadaşım eşek. Yaban tayları çayırda tepişiyor mu? Çilli horoz kedilerle dövüşüyor mu? Sarı kız minik uzavıyı sütten kesti mi? Kuzularla oğlaklar sevişiyor mu? Uzun kulaklarını son bir kez salla. Tüm eski dostlarına...
Bayağı avcı gibi yani. Önceden böyle tripleri yoktu tabii. Ben işte doğum yaptıktan sonra böyle oldu. Ondan öncesi şurada full uyku. Bütün gün burada dinleniyor.
Arkadaşım eşek, arkadaşım eş, arkadaşım şek, arkadaşım eşek.
Accept the 2018 Chlotrudis Award for Best Documentary. Please welcome Ceyda Torun and Charlie Wupperman.
Hi, thank you for having us. Thank you so much for having us and thank you for this award. It's such an honor to be recognized by your society for many reasons, but especially for supporting independent and world cinema. It means a lot to us, thank you.
And an award shaped as a cat, amazing. I mean, nothing could be more fitting.
Great, thank you so much, Ceyda and Charlie. Congratulations.
Thank you.
To hear more about Ceyda and Charlie's work, we asked Chlotrudis friend and ally, Cheryl Egan Donovan, to have a chat with them. Documentary filmmaker and Controversy Films founder Cheryl's film, Nothing is Truer Than Truth, is currently available on Amazon Prime and is being released in Europe and the rest of the world under the title Shakespeare, Behind the Name, later this year. She recently received a grant to travel to London and conduct research for her next documentary project about a group of poets and playwrights in late 16th century London. She is also developing an episodic series on London's music and fashion scene in the 1970s. Let's see what Ceyda and Charlie have to say about KEDI.
Hi, Ceyda and Charlie. It's so nice to meet both of you.
Likewise, very nice to meet you.
Congratulations on your Trudy Award for Best Documentary 2018 for your film, KEDI. We all really love the film so much. And I know that you've both received several awards in your careers, but I'm sure this one is special because it's the only film award that I'm aware of that's named for a cat. And as a documentary filmmaker, I know that one of the great joys of making a documentary feature is becoming immersed in a community and then sharing that discovery with others. And we all fell in love with the stars of your film, the many different quirky and fearless cats and their human friends. So I know we'd really like to get an update on the cats, how they're doing, and if you've had a chance to go back to visit Istanbul.
We try to stay in touch with them as much as possible because we also, you're right, we fell in love with them as much as you did, and getting to physically be with them during the shoot, we formed some attachments. We both had sort of favorites and cats that we cared a little bit more or less about. And we've been back, we went back last time about a year and a half ago, and we got to see most of them. Some of them had passed on because of age or some other thing, but most of them are around, and we try to stay in touch with their human counterparts. And we're hopefully going to visit them in about a month or so and see how they're all doing so we can send some updates.
That's great, great. And also during the film, towards the end, you mentioned that they were kind of in danger of being displaced because of all of the construction. So How is that going? Are they still ruling the territory?
I think they're occasionally displaced, just, you know, temporarily displaced, but they seem to find a way back to being a very important part of the city. I can't imagine, and I hope they will never truly go away. And my hope with the film was to document how things are, and with a wish to preserve how things are. And I think, despite the construction and despite the ever-changing nature of the city, the people who live in the city really make a great effort to keep the cats, especially, as true to their nature as possible. And I know that even during the pandemic, there's been a greater emphasis on the part of the inhabitants of the city to bring in the cats indoors and take care of them, because they were, you know, curfews and lockdowns where you couldn't go outside for a couple of days at a time. So
right,
people have really embraced the street cats even more.
That's great. Good to hear.
Yeah.
And one of the other things I wanted to talk about, of course, is the cinematography, because it's really beautiful. It's quite amazing. And that includes the cat's eye view from the streets to the shots on the water, which definitely reminded me of shooting in Venice. And then the aerial shots of the rooftops of Istanbul, where the cats also rule. And I was wondering, when you made the decision to shoot from the cat's perspective, and what were the challenges in that process? Can you talk about that?
Well, I'm going to end.
Yeah, please.
We obviously looked at a lot of nature documentaries and other documentaries about animals before we had it out to film. And there was definitely, you know, there's a documentary about lions, and it's shot all with like long lenses from far away because nobody wants to get that close.
Right.
Of course. But with the cats, we knew they're so comfortable with people and you can be so close to them. So we really wanted to get into their world and film them with wide angle lenses from their perspective. And I think the other major decision we made on very early on was that we didn't want humans to be the main actors or main characters. It was the cats. So we like, even if we never see the people, just their feet, we want to be with the cats and experience Istanbul from their perspective. So that's where we came up with the over the shoulder following the cats and all these kind of shots.
For which you had to create a new rig.
Well, yeah, I mean, to not break your back, we
yeah,
some contraptions together. And then in terms of the aerials, we realized if you just see everything from the cat's perspective, you never get a sense of how big the city is. And you
right,
need to get out and get away from the narrow streets and alleys just to see the scale and the size of the city. So, and I think in the editing, it turned out this really nice transition, like gave you a second to breathe and
yes. Yeah, it's really, it is breathtaking. It's beautiful. And it's great to see all the different neighborhoods too. It was just really beautifully shot. So thank you for that. Yeah. And another question I had was about the music. I really loved the music. And I know that you've done some music videos, Charlie, but did you work with the composer to create different motifs for the film, or how did that work, that process?
Well, our wonderful composer, Kira Fontana, she had worked with us in putting together some score for the trailer that we made for the film initially about a year earlier when we were securing funding and securing participants for the film. And so we returned to work with her, and she knew, I was very adamant that we didn't create a Turkish sound just because I wanted to convey the notion that these cats are, you know, eternally in that place, and they're not, they don't belong to a particular nation of people or a geographic location necessarily even. And there's she proposed, and through identifying pieces of music that we liked, she found a way to capture their lightness and their presence with this chimey, it's all percussions. It's all chimes, percussions in her score, which then creates that ethereal feeling and yet playful cat nature. And I selected, I was very keen to find pieces of music that were either by Turkish musicians who were influenced by Western music and Western musicians who were influenced by Turkish music. to also once again bring forth that idea that Istanbul and cats are part of this East meets West persona of Istanbul. They fit into that personality as well. And so there's a lot of songs that are very significant to Turkish audiences, where they pick up nostalgic music.
Yes, I recognize.
And then there's some that are recognizable to Western audiences, like Eartha Kitt and some, you know, British jazz musicians that people might recognize. And so that was an effort to create a sense of familiarity and a sense of wanting a sense of an emotional response from the audience for the cats and the stories.
Great. And you also mentioned that you have two children and that they were involved in the process of making the film. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure. Well, I was pregnant with our first daughter while we were filming. And I have to say it was the most wonderful experience because, you know, the cats would come and purr on my big belly. And I had a sense that they knew what was happening. So there was a lot of times they were very welcoming to me. I think they sensed that I could be the least dangerous human to them. And it also helped with the human interviews, to be honest with you. People are very open to pregnant women. It's not a hindrance for female filmmakers. Ironically, when I was pregnant with our second daughter, we were promoting the film a lot, and both our daughters seen the film multiple times, and our older daughter would give feedback from the beginning while we were editing.
Great.
Things were cheap. And they you know, their favorite game is to play cat, so they frequently meow around the house.
That's great. I love it. The last thing I wanted to ask you, because we don't have a lot of time, is what you're both working on now. What are you working on currently, if you can tell us a little bit about current projects?
Our next documentary project that we're doing together is on divination and fortune telling and around the world, the approach to, we'd like to capture practices of divination around the world, but also bring up, you know, conversations around the themes of existence and our relationship to the divine, our relationship to each other, to our own subconscious and the collective subconscious. So there's some fun themes that we're exploring through the process of the practice of divination around the world. Hopefully we're going to start shooting something over the summer in Turkey as well. And to see the cats. And we have some fictional narrative projects that we're working on as well.
Great. And how about you, Charlie? Anything else that you're doing? Are you going to do another James Corden karaoke?
At the moment, no, but yeah, I'm always shooting other projects and do a lot of commercials and music videos and the occasional other documentary. But it's been slow the last year.
I know, there's really been nothing, but really
excited. I think it's going to be a busy year.
Great. Well, we're looking forward to it. We're really looking forward to seeing your next film. And thank you again for joining us for the Chlotrudis Awards, and congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye. Take care.
Bye. Thank you, Ceyda and Charlie. Congratulations on your award. And thank you, Cheryl, for that great interview. Now for our next batch of awards, the technical awards, I'd like to introduce Chlotrudis board member Nancy Campbell and Chlotrudis member Jeff Pike.
Hi, I'm Jeff.
Hello, I'm Nancy. So Jeff and I are going to read the nominations for technical awards. I'm going to start by reading the nominees for best use of music in a film. And then we danced. Zviad Magabri, music supervisor. I'm No Longer Here, Javier Nuno and Joe Rodriguez, music supervisors. Lovers Rock, Michael Levy, composer. Ed Bailey and Abby Lepland, music supervisors. Nobody Knows I'm Here, Carlos Cabezas, music supervisor. Sylvie's Love, Fabrice LeCompte, composer, Frankie Pine, music supervisor, Stephen Argilla, music producer. And Jeff is going to reveal it.
And the winner for best use of music in a film is, we have a tie. First of all, for And Then We Dance, Ziad Mghebri, music supervisor, and Lovers Rock, Micah Levy, composer, Ed Bailey, and Abby Leland, music supervisors. And now I will read the nominations for best production design. Sergei Ivanov for Beanpole, Anthony Gasparo for First Cow, Molly Hughes and Marissa Lombardo for I'm Thinking of Ending Things, Thomas Grezeau, Portrait of a Lady on Fire, Julien Tremblay for The 20th Century, and Adam Dietrich for The Vast of Night.
I'm going to be very dramatic with the analog. And the winner is, or the treaty goes to, Sergei Ivanov, Beanpole. And the next category, nominees for best editing. Robert Frazen, I'm Thinking of Ending Things. Chris Dickens and Steve McQueen, Lovers Rock. Gabriel Rhodes, Time. Matthew Rankin, The 20th Century. And Andrew Patterson, The Vast of Night.
And the winner for best editing is Andrew Patterson for The Vast of Night. And now the awards nominated for best cinematography. Mauro Herz for Fire Will Come, Benjamin Craquant for Monsoon, Claire Matome for Portrait of a Lady on Fire, Caitlin Arizmendi for Swallow, and M.I. Lithon-Lenz for The Vast of Night.
And the Trudy goes to And I think I threw it out, didn't I? I managed to throw it out behind me. Nope. Who is the winner? I will consult this other piece of paper I've written things down on. Claire Matone, Portrait of a Lady on Fire. Congratulations to all of our technical winners.
Respirando. Una más. Todo bien. Viene nomás para el parto. No te preocupes de la plata, ¿eh?
another powerful film, A Song Without a Name. You won't want to miss this because, you know, when you hear the words, don't worry about money, you know, you have to worry about something. So do try to watch that film. It's pretty wonderful. As those of you who caught the pre-show may have surmised, Chlotrudis has a tradition of performing musical numbers at our award ceremonies. This year, we were not able to put together and rehearse our usual style of performance, but longtime member, frequent musical collaborator, and our newest board member, Diane Young, has put together something very special for us with original lyrics by Diane and with thanks and permission from Adele for the music. Here's something that looks back on the past year without our beloved movie theaters.
Goodbye as the movie screens shut down. No final chance to sniffle with the crowd. Now it's been a year and I've watched them all from home. 'Cause I've got my Netflix queue and my Disney Plus and my big TV and my Chlotrudis pals all on Zoom. So who needs the theater? Shush the back row drone, or curse those jerks who kept lighting up their phones. I often think about how much dough I've saved, and I went to Sundance without getting on a plane. I don't miss the sticky floors and ticket stubs and the lengthy pause before the festival Q&A. Who needs the theater? I went to Sundance. At home, a but I can't keep track of my live streams. Films don't look right on a home-sized screen. Will somebody meet me at the movies, please? It's lonely when it's just me. Oh, we need the theater. Yes, we need.
Thank you, Diane. Brings a little tear to my eye. Hopefully we'll all be able to see each other at the movies again later this year. We're getting close to the end, so I want to introduce Vicky Oleski, a board member, and Chris Kriowski, our board treasurer, to give us the next round of awards around the big ones, the big movies.
Chris?
Just looking for Chris. Is Chris there? Chris, here he is.
There he is. Hi, everyone. I'm so sorry, my computer's messed up. Hello?
Hello.
You're back.
Okay, so we're doing the nominee. Hold on 1 second. Hello?
We're doing best director, best documentary, best film. And Chris is going to start.
I'll do the nominees for best director.
Okay.
I'll read the nominees for Eliza Hittman for Never, Rarely, Sometimes, Always. And Celine for Portrait of a Lady on Fire.
And the winner is Eliza Hittman for Never, Rarely, Sometimes, Always. And now we have the best documentary. The nominees are Boys State, Crip Camp, Dick Johnson is Dead, The Rabbi Goes West, and Time. And
oh, you'll have to do it on your own, Vicky.
Oh dear. Okay, well, the winner is Time. And let's see, we have the, oops, I don't have the best, because I didn't think I was going to do it. So now I have to find the best film nominations. I don't have the best film. Do you have them, Michael? I don't have the best film nominations because.
I do. Give me 1 second.
Okay. Sorry.
The nominations for Best Movie are And Then We Danced, First Cow, Never, Rarely, Sometimes, Always, Portrait of a Lady on Fire, and Sound of Metal.
And the winner is Portrait of a Lady on Fire. Congratulations to all the winners.
Thanks, Vicky. So as we're nearing the end of our ceremony, I'd like to take one last look back to our challenging year and talk a little bit about how Chlotrudis, like everyone else, adjusted for lockdown. Through the generosity of our dear movie-loving former board member, Bruce Kingsley, who bequeathed a significant sum to Chlotrudis in his will, we had set up a fund to send members to film festivals throughout the year. Bruce loved film festivals, and there were many among us who can fondly remember spending time with Bruce, discussing films passionately at various festivals. Our plan had been to set aside up to $10,000 a year as grants for members to offset the cost of attending a film festival. Even before the pandemic, it was getting harder and harder to see independent and international films on the big screen. And that's where the film festivals really helped us. Whether it was the Toronto International Film Festival, Grand Dame of Public Fests, the hip crowds of South by Southwest or Tribeca, or the local favorites, IFF Boston or the Provençal International Film Festival, near and far, we would support our members' desire to see films in the dark, in a crowd, on a big screen. Except we couldn't do that last year. Festivals all went virtual, and while we certainly could have supported members to attend virtual film festivals, we saw a better use for the funding in 2020. We used that $10,000 allotment to support local independent cinemas. From our hometown heroes, the Brattle Theater, the Coolidge Corner Theater, the Water's Edge Cinema in Provincetown, to the Little Theater in Rochester, New York, Film Forum in New York City, the Belcourt in Nashville, Cinemopolis in Ithaca, New York, the Arrow in the Egyptian in Los Angeles. These were all cinemas where our members have enjoyed independent cinema throughout the years. And in a year where cinemas all across the country were forced to shut their doors, some possibly forever, we did what little we could to help. And tonight I'm announcing a continuation of that support for our beloved cinemas. In addition to supporting our members who may want to attend a virtual film festival, and who knows, maybe later this year, a live in-person film festival, we'll also be sending out a second round of donations for independent cinemas across the country. As Diane so eloquently sang, we miss the theater. And now we're gonna have our last clip for our buried treasure nominees.
The plan is simple. In this vial, there is a substance with no color, smell, or taste. If you dissolve it in a glass of water, nobody will notice. You'll give it to Jolt to drink it, and he will feel sick. Then you call for an ambulance, and he will be taken to the hospital.
The vial takes effect within half an hour. And after that, within another half hour, the doctor will have to give him an injection of cortisone. Otherwise, he will die.
Any ambulance has cortisone.
Hello.
Hello.
Buenas tardes. Buenas tardes. I'm a filmmaker, and I'm scouting locations for my next project. I love the look of this factory from the outside, but is it possible, do you mind if I check it out from the inside too?
Yeah, why not? Come in.
It's beautiful.
Well, that one didn't end so well for him, but it's a fun, quirky caper film, and that rounds out our nominees for Buried Treasure. I do want to just call attention to, we're about to announce our last award, and then I'm putting one more time in the chat for all of you to see. After this is over, we're gonna shut down this meeting, and then we will have an after party where we'll be open, so you can join the after party. I'm gonna put the link as soon as I grab it in the chat. And then, wait, it's not working, why not? Oh, there it is. So if you wanna join us afterwards, we'll be in this Zoom room here in the chat where you can come and interact with all of the attendees. So, and here we go. For our final award of the night, the Buried Treasure, I'd like to introduce board member Gil Cordova and Amanda Doran, who helped us with the logistics of this event tonight. They're going to give you the nominations and the winner of the Buried Treasure Award.
Hello, everybody. No, it's a big deal to be doing the Buried Treasure, the signature award. You know, in the past, some of the former presenters really lobbied hard for this award, and you know, they were doing all these sketches and jokes and costume changes. And I was wondering like whether we should have been doing something or planned something. So, you know, I found this miner's helmet, you know, in Elise's closet to go with the whole, you know, buried treasure theme. What do you think? Yeah. No, no, all right.
All right, so the nominees are Cat in the Wall, Ghost Tropic, Light from Light, Morona's Fantastic Tale, Song Without a Name, and The Whistlers.
And the Trudy for Buried Treasure goes to, it's a tie between Ghost Tropic and Light from Light.
And I don't know, Paul is still here. I don't know if we can promote him to presenter, Jay. And you, if you're still there, you may want to say a few words. Congratulations, Paul. Maybe he's not there anymore.
Oh, no, I'm here.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
Really exciting. Thank you, everybody. Super touched. And this is not, I'm just going to accept this on behalf of everybody who was involved in this film. It was very much a team effort. A lot of people put a lot of heart and soul into this film. So it means a lot. Thanks very much.
I'll follow up with you, Paul, so I can get an address where I can ship to you your own Trudy. So that brings us to the end of our event. We all just want to say thank you very much for attending, sticking it through. We went a little bit over time, not too bad, but it was, you know, getting used to that whole virtual experience. As I said, please copy the Zoom information in the chat if you want to join us for the after party. We'll be shutting this meeting down in a few minutes, and then I'll open up the after party in about 5 minutes, and we'll see how that works. So everyone, thanks very much. Enjoy. Go see some great movies. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
I can't start the next one until this one ends. So I'll sit here until you end it, Jay, and then I'll go and start the other one.
Oh, sorry about that. We'll end now. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Jay. I'll be in touch.
Michael, can you email the link?